Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Vikram Barate from GS Lab, and my colleague Himanshu Purohit, who is working as architect from GS Lab. We have been working on OMEC project from like MCOR days for like around 2 years or more. We have been involved in multiple developments, restructuring of multiple components, ground up design of multiple components in OMEC. So that was in research phase when we started working. As you have seen in last 2 years, the research phase has been successfully passed, as we demonstrated in multiple conferences this year and last year. Now we are entering into a phase for taking it to the production or real test of the waters. So in this transition from research phase to the productionization phase, what are the challenges that we are facing? We want to tell more on those things and how we are addressing those challenges. So along with that, I will also with the productionization things, what is the roadmap ahead of us for the OMEC? We'll talk more on that. And at the end, we'll also give some proposals or some our thoughts on how to move OMEC now to the 5G, because that is the obvious expectation going ahead from OMEC. So we'll have our phase by phase or step by step plan for moving OMEC to the 5G. Okay, so this is the diagram you must have seen in other presentation as well. So to summarize, OMEC is a suite of multiple components working together to form evolved packet core. And if you look at each component, they have their own set of requirements, architecture requirements or specification requirements from 3GPP point of view. So each component here is, though they is developing C++, each one has its own way of building the component, configuration of the component, its own way of launching the component. And that brings the complexity to, if someone wants to launch EPC, that adds to the complexity of anyone to understand and launch this EPC very easily. So for this, to solve this problem, we have a deployment repository, which is part of the OMEC project itself. We had a tutorial on that on our tutorial date for how to use that. So using that, you can avoid the complexity and just in a single click, you just define your schematic for the EPC, and in a single click, you can have your EPC up and running with all the configuration and builds. So next, we would like to cover more on the architectural challenges that we are facing in this transition from the gateway point of view. So let me call up my colleague Himanshu Purohit, who is working as architect. Is that working?
Yeah, hi. So I'm going to talk on architectural challenges in gateways with respect to 3GPP spec and deployment and rule engine. So as you all know, that 3GPP spec specifies the behavior of protocol or component. It doesn't specify or it doesn't detail out the implementation. It's left on the reader. So let's take example of 23214. Specification 23214 specifies or it details out the CUPS architecture. Now it has got two things, like split architecture, that's on your right hand side, and we have got combined one. Now 23214 talks about, it's all about the message flow or procedures. It's all about the split one. It only describes this combined one in a single page. So it's like, okay, so we have implemented SXA protocol and SXB, that's in split architecture, and then converge both into SXA and SXB, and then we have this combined architecture. If we take example of like interfaces, so we have many interfaces in gateway, like GX, SX, S11, S5, S8. Now, mapping of parameters or information element or AVPs of one interface to another interface is missing in spec. So let's take example like RAR message received on GX interface. And once you receive RAR, you have to send PFCP session modification request to user plane. Now converting GX message into SX message is missing. So by carefully aggregating all the specs, we are able to create the correct mapping between all the AVPs or the all the information elements. One more thing, there are number of messages and number of parameters in each message and on each interface. It's like on S11 we have around 32 messages and 130 plus information elements. So encoding and decoding of this parameter becomes a headache. So you can't go and manually write all those things, encoders and decoders. So we have created tools which generates the encoder and decoder libraries for all the messages and all the information element or the parameters or the AVPs. Next comes the deployment. So when we talk about deployment, there are things to consider, like there are multiple interfaces and each interface has got its own requirement or its own characteristics. Then comes the OSS support. Then we have restoration. So we are also adding all these features and that will be part of OMEC deployment repo. Oh, yeah. And the last one is the rule engine. So rule engine, what I mean by is rule engine or the packet filtering, packet processing in user plane. So currently, the rule engine of user plane is tightly coupled with DPDK, and which means the limitations of DPDK also gets applied to user plane. For example, QoS is not supported in DPDK, so our user plane doesn't support QoS. So there should be kind of, we should decouple this rule engine from interface and the implementation, and it should be designed in such a way that it should work with DPDK or VPP or maybe P4, something like BESS. And we are in early stage of designing this, where we can create a plug and play kind of module. Yeah. Thank you. I'll hand over to Vikram.
Yeah. Thank you. So based on the phase that we are going through, let me go ahead and talk more on the road ahead item, the item that we are already working on, or item that we need to work on to make it a full-fledged product, production-ready gateway. So first thing to talk about is scalability and dynamic. So if you look at current architecture or current code base, it's pretty much static. I mean, S-Gateway is hard-coded to talk to a certain MME. S-Gateway is hard-coded to talk to certain user plane component. And so there is a tight coupling. So, and this model is not going to scale. So that is the one thing that we are adding right now, that at runtime, control plane will be able to identify all the MMEs that are talking to the control plane. And then based on the kind of mobile connection you are getting, the UE connection you are getting, based on certain parameters, S-Gateway will take a define which particular user plane it needs to forward this connection to. So this all decisions will be taken dynamically, and we are referring to specification 23003, 23007 for that, because this is going to help on dynamically launching the component, bringing down the component. Also, this is going to help us in the restoration flows. So this is one item which is in development. CLI statistics is like a basic requirement. If you take it to operation guys, this is the basic thing that they expect. Not having this is like totally unexpected thing. But if you consider CLI or statistics, the way to run the CLI, each OSS or each deployment may have its own way of running the CLI. Some can be based on simply CLI commands, some can be based on RESTful or gRPC or something else. So we cannot implement all the CLIs in gateway. So what we are doing is we are adding hooks into the gateway code to do get and set operations. So, and we will limit that to the implementation of those hooks only. In OMEC project, there is a utility called OSS Utils, which is specially designed to unify all the CLI statistics logging operation across all the components of OMEC. So we are going to take this OSS util and we will be developing a REST-based interface which will invoke all the CLI hooks, and it will expose RESTful interface to your application. So you can have your OSS implemented in the RESTful interface. But if you say you don't want to go for the OSS util, you want to implement your own CLI, all hooks are in place in the code. And you can have your own applications invoking those hooks and exposing interface the way we want. So we're just trying to segregate the implementation of those get set handlers and the interface, which can be based on your own OSS utilities. So lawful interception, as it was discussed yesterday multiple times, Lyle from Sprint, Michael Sevara from T-Mobile, Nikhil Joshi from GS Lab, everyone talk a lot on this. This is the one critical component for all the deployments, but you cannot have it completely in open source because of obvious restriction. So here also we are going to follow the same model that we're going to follow in CLI. We will be having the required provisions, required hooks made into the code. Implementation or customization based on the deployment or the regulatory parameters will be left to the deployment owners or the operators. But required hooks or required parameters, API support will be provided into code with some reference to the specifications. So current gateway code is pretty much, as I said, is in research mode. So it supports certain flows in certain combinations. So if you, it supports basically attach and detach. But if you consider 403 is 401 and 214, there are more than 30 to 40 flows, combination of flows. For example, you need to support dedicated bearer, handover scenarios. And there are many more flows that you need to support. There are then timers, there are asynchronous events, there are error conditions that need to support. So for that, we need a very strong framework in the gateway because it's combination of multiple things going on in one center. And this is where we are going to follow the design paradigm that we had followed for MME. And we are building a framework for gateway to make it actually able to support all those complexity which are there in the specification. So this is also one part in the roadmap development. So conformance is a big challenge. I will share my experience on MME as well on this side. We are doing conformance right now with the tools, all the industry standards tools, NG40, Spiron, Polaris, developing solutions. But when it comes to conformance with the actual device, when we connect to the real MME or maybe SP gateways from some third party, S gateways from OMEC, then we are going to face the challenges. I will share experience on MME on that side. So this is one thing we have not done much on the gateways yet. T-Mobile Poland has started actually deploying with real MME, and they shared their experience yesterday. But conformance with the real end devices or real deployments is something we are really looking forward. So 5G readiness is something which obvious question that has been coming up in last few days. So what are we doing in that effort? So if you look at SX, the 29244, is part of the release 15. So we are already moving one part of gateways towards 5G. If you consider SMF and AMF, SMF is kind of combined S gateway, P gateway architecture. I mean, S gateway and P gateway combined as on the control side, which is exactly mapping to the SA gateway C that we have. Same way for user plane, it's combined, you can say S gateway and P gateway and user plane. So that is also mapping to SA gateway U that we have. And as I said, SX is in that's in progress and it will be coming soon. So gateways are pretty much like partially at least migrating towards the 5G. So a lot of deployment scenarios or multiple discussions come across the backward compatibility because there are many deployments which are still running on 3G or 2.5G. And there are requests coming for like support for GTP V1 or GGSN interface. So that is not right now in roadmap for the ONF. To develop backward compatibility for our overall OMEC components. But with the framework that we are talking, we will be having provision into the gateways. So in case someone wants to take interest and develop backward compatibility, GTP V1C, framework will be provided if someone is interested and take it forward. So let me come to MME a bit. So I would like to tell more on architectural bit history on how it is being designed. So basically, when we started MME, obviously there was question for MME to be in place, which will do the basic operation. But main design consideration that we had, in place was it should be able to support 500K UE connections with attach rate of 1000 per second. So if you consider 1000 per second attach rate, it means you have to complete one attach in 1 millisecond. And if you consider MME, there are 8 different stages that MME needs to go through to complete one attach. That means you have to complete one stage in 125 microseconds. Now, this was a tough problem to solve. So we had a lot of architectural models, mathematical models designed with help of Intel Labs researchers. We proved it on the paper, then we proved it in the code, and we got this MME into OMEC, which is working there. But is it a ready MME to go for a deployment state or any production ready state? Obviously, no. There are a lot of missing pieces we need to work on. For example, the framework completion things that I mentioned for MME, those applies to the one I mentioned for gateways. Those applies to MME as well. But for MME, it applies to much complex level. MME is more complex than the gateways, and this framework to support all the timers, all kind of flows, various handover scenarios, etc. For that, we need a strong framework in MME. So we have a team working on this in collaboration with multiple partners. So compliance challenges I want to bring up specifically for MME. So as I mentioned, we are testing with standard tools like Polaris, NG40, Spirent. So MME passed test for all those simulators. But when we connected MME to the real InnodeB and real UE, it immediately failed on the first test only. So that's a conformance challenge, and somehow we were able to get beyond that. But the S1 side or the wireless side is real challenge for the MMEs, because based on each InnodeB, there are variations that needs to be handled in MME. And not only to limit to that, there are variations based on the UEs as well. So we have to do variations for S1 as well as the NAS messages in MME. So let me give a short overview on how we can migrate our current OMEC to the 5G. So as I mentioned earlier, some of the components are already kind of mapping to, you can say, SMF and AMF, and gateways, especially SMF and AMF, can pretty much independently migrate to the 5G readiness. Obviously, we need to add session management into SMF, which will be delegated from MME or AMF now in case of 5G. The way MME is designed, let me just go back and talk a bit on that. So the way MME is designed, there is a core engine that is performing all the business logic, and we have all interface applications running separate. So we have segregated the core engine from all the interfaces. So this was designed at a time when 5G specification was not in place, but we knew it was going to be service-based architecture. So we didn't know exactly what is needed. So that is why we separated out all the interface applications. So in case we want to move one particular interface to service-based architecture, it should not impact rest of the elements. And same can be applied for migrating MME to AMF. So taking the same thread ahead, let me propose. So this is a proposal for how we can transition current OMEC to 5G in step-by-step approach. This proposal obviously needs to go through the technical steering committee and architects. So what I am proposing here is basically we can keep our current setup as it is. OMEC will still run on 4G. Connection will still be on InnodeB on 4G side. But what we'll do is we'll add an AMF interface. As I mentioned in MME architecture, you can simply add extra interface logics. We'll add an AMF interface in MME, and we will support handover case. From MME to MME, S1 handover case we will support. So that way we will have N AMF in place, so MME will start migrating towards 5G. Once we have a handler supported, again, every rest, including the EPC and rest, everything will be still running on 4G. Once handler scenario is supported, we will have framework for NAMF in place. Then using same framework, we will add support for N1, N2. Basically, then we will have convergence implemented for Gnode B. And once that interface comes in place, we will have rest of the AESA translation, etc., trigger from the MME point of view. So, yeah, so that's the proposed way how we can step by step go. And as I mentioned, gateways are pretty much independently transitioning towards 5G. So that was all about what we were in the research phase and how we are going towards the productionization, what are the things that we are facing and how we are addressing that. So any suggestion or questions on that front is welcome. Yes.
Hi. Thanks very much, first of all, for this talk. So very interesting to see. Just wanted to understand, maybe you can help me with a rule of thumb or some thought of like rough estimation of how much effort would it be to migrate this component MME and then maybe also overall the current OMEC implementation to those 5G compliant interfaces. So in terms of maybe time or effort, just sort of as a ballpark.
Yeah, yeah. So timeline, maybe not effort-wise, I can tell you. So as I mentioned, gateways are already kind of migrating towards that to become SMF and AMF. AUSF is one big piece which we need to interface, implement, and then NAMF will be the big piece which we need to implement. Once those are in picture, I think adding N11 or other components will not be a big challenge. There is also a dependency from specification point of view. I mean, specifications are not very clear as of now. Interface messages are mentioned, but contents are not very clear exactly what is going to go in the handshake. Once those details are clear, the immediate number which comes in my mind, which can be right or wrong, we can figure out is, I think 4 to 6 months should be enough to get basic framework in place for months. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Because it's a service-based architecture. I mean, once you develop your NAMF kind of component for rest of the interfaces, all you have to do is develop service and invoke the right service. So in case of 4G, it's like for each and every interface, you have to follow the specific standards for each and every component or interface handshakes. Here, once you have your framework in place for the services, it's just a matter of invoking the right services.